Good morning, church. How's everybody doing today? Just wanted to give you guys a few updates. We are doing Hanging of the Greens on December 3rd. That's a Tuesday at 6:30 p.m. That's for the decorating of the church, if you're available to help out with that. That is not going to be decorating of the fellowship hall. That we're going to do on Friday about 6:30 in the evening. So if y'all are available to decorate the fellowship hall and could come back for that, please do. We are going to be having our NCC Christmas dinner on December 7th. It's going to begin at 5 o'clock. We have a lot of fun things planned for you guys, and we hope that you can make it. We do have a sign-up sheet in the front. It's potluck for the side, so if you guys want to get on the list and put a side that you're going to be putting on there, I know that I would really enjoy that. So I hope that you guys can make it, and we'll see you there. It's going to be a lot of fun. Like I said, it's always a blast, and we're going to take lots of pictures, and it's a good time. We're having our Christmas Eve candlelight service on Christmas Eve. It's going to be about 5 o'clock in the evening. It's a beautiful, beautiful service. I hope all of you can make it. It's also a great time to invite friends and family. It's a great time to praise the Lord and just be full of love and thankfulness, and it's a great time. We also ask, if it's your first time here, if it's your 100th time here, that you please fill out the connection card. It's inside your bulletin. It looks like this. But the important part of it, I mean, both sides are important, obviously, but for me at least, the prayer request side on the back of the card is really, really important. We are a praying church. We have many, many people here who are just led to pray. And so fill out that prayer card on the back for anything that's weighing on your heart, anything that you want to give the Lord praise. There are a lot of people who are here that would want to pray for you. The staff prays for these every week. If you want to keep it confidential, our whole church prays for these. We send them out. If you want to keep it confidential, there's a little part on the bottom that you can check off, and that won't go out. The staff will still pray for you, though. And just have a great Sunday. Have a blessed week. Thank you.
Good morning. Good to see you. I just have a quick question. This is a Thanksgiving week, as you know, we're coming up and on that. And so we really wanted to just obviously have our whole time focusing on Thanksgiving today. And so I just want to have a time or moment to see if we could just have anyone who would like just kind of stand up and just say something you're thankful for. We'll just take a moment or two. Anyone, if you're thankful for something, do you want to just raise your hand, or you can just say something? Well, you don't have to do anything else. Just say, yeah, I'm thankful for this. We're just going to give it a shot. Yeah.
I'm thankful for my mom and my dad.
Awesome. For your parents. Not many kids would say that's awesome. That's great. Yeah, Jenny.
I'm thankful for you.
Oh, thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you, Jenny. Someone else? I saw a hand over here somewhere. Oh, yeah.
I'm thankful for the canopy of prayer that's been going out for Winston, and he and I have been starting our day first by reading the prayer for the day.
Awesome. Thank you. That's great. Thank you. Someone else? Something you're thankful for? Yeah.
Good health.
Good health. Amen. Amen. Thank the Lord for that. Amen. Yeah. Yes, Ken.
Thankful for gainful employment.
Amen. Amen. Thank you very much. A lot of people don't consider. Hi, Frank. Yeah. Amen. Thank you. Amen. Thank you so much, friend. Thank you. Yeah, Eleanor. Amen. We can even be here to do that. Amen. Thank you. And Norma, did you say? For your family. Amen. Okay, one more, because I know we're getting. Okay, yeah. Hey, Rebecca. Amen. Praise the Lord for that. Amen. Praise the Lord. Well, good. Absolutely. There's just so many things we can be thankful for, and you guys just did a really good job right there. Right now, can we have the kids stand up? We're going to pray for our kids to for them to have a great time as they learn about Thanksgiving today. Father God, we want to thank you for our kids. We pray, Lord, as they go to their class, that they have fun, learn about you, Lord, and learn a new thing they can be thankful for to you for. And we pray, Jesus, that you would just bless them and they would have a great time. And, Lord, be with the workers as well. Lord, just be with them all together. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thanks, kiddos. Have a great time. God bless you. All right, well, it's great to see everyone. Thank you for everyone here. I want to just talk a little bit today. It is Thanksgiving. We want to talk a little bit, as a third of our congregation leaves. Amen, exactly. Isn't that exciting? That's awesome. I want to just talk a little bit about Thanksgiving, of course, and just about the blessing of that and the value of that. So, of course, this is about Thanksgiving. Too often, have you noticed how it seems like Christmas decorations go up earlier every year? Have you noticed that? Isn't that funny? I'm okay with that because I love Christmas too. But the one thing I get concerned about is there's a neat holiday that kind of gets bypassed because of it. Amen? Thanksgiving. And so it's really important that we have our time to really thank the Lord and not just kind of think it was an afterthought, that giving him thanks should be central. And so can we all stand right now? We're going to focus a little bit and just pray. We're going to pray and then we're going to read God's word if you want to stand there and about Thanksgiving. Let's pray together right now. Father God, you're such an awesome God. Thank you, Lord, for bringing us here this morning for Thanksgiving, to give you thanks. Lord, people got a chance to share just a little bit ago different things they're thankful for. And we ask God right now, Lord, as we get into your word and have our time together, we ask, Lord, we'd even find more things to be thankful for, and God, that you'd help us to develop more of a thankful mindset. You're such an awesome God, Lord. You deserve our best, and certainly you deserve our thanks. So we do thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. If you can remain standing, we're going to be reading from Ephesians chapter 5, verse 20. And give thanks for everything to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Thanks. You may be seated.
When something caught Madame Blueberry's eye.
I thank God for this day, for the sun in the sky, for my mom and my dad, for my piece of apple pie, for our home on the ground, for his love that's all around. That's why I say thanks.
I don't think we can afford that right now, Junior. How about a ball?
Thank you, Dad, for our day, for our trip to the mall, for the time just with me, for my big red bouncy ball, for the fun that we had. I'm so happy you're my dad. That's why I say thanks every day.
Because a thankful heart is a happy heart.
I'm glad for
God who really cares,
and he listens to our prayers. That's why I say thanks every day. That's why we say thanks every day.
Madame Blueberry, I want to take some moments together and just look at the value of maintaining a thankful mentality or a thankful heart. We're going to talk about just how we can even do it, developing a thankful disposition. And then we're going to talk about not the value of it, but we're also going to talk about how God's given us an ace up our sleeve, so to speak, a means to help us develop a thankful heart all the time. And I want to talk, first of all, just why I can always be thankful. You know, there are different reasons why we can be thankful. By the way, in your program, you should have a little fill-in-the-blank. And if you want to follow through, that's great. Right now, I'm just going to be a little practical. We already read Scripture, Ephesians chapter 5, verse 20, how God's encouraged us to be thankful all the time and said, for everything, give thanks for everything to God the Father. But that's not always easy, is it? But there's been study after study, do you believe it or not? People have done studies on the value and the benefits of people being thankful and what that, how we personally can yield great benefits from it. Gia Kanesh, she wrote an article called Why Grateful People Live Longer and Live a Happier Life. And in that, she summarized all these different studies that they've done at different colleges and universities, seeing the value of the benefit that people actually receive for being thankful. And so she summarized them, and we're going to look at them right now. I'm going to summarize her summary, basically. But these are the things she said. She said, first of all, she mentioned how Stephen Covey said that if we develop a mindset and growth of well-being, he said there's a tendency if we have a scarcity mindset, we tend to think negatively. But if we have an abundant mindset where we realize that there's plenty out there and enough spare for everyone, he says that gives us a positive mentality for a positive outcome. She went on to say, here are some of the results I've seen from various studies. For example, one, you'll feel happy if you have a thankful mindset. You'll feel happier. One study by Robert Emmons from the University of Berkeley, California, he divided participants into three different groups. He asked them to maintain a journal for 10 weeks. One group was asked to write a list of 10 things they were grateful for the past week. The second group was asked to list 10 minor annoyances that past week. And the third group was just asked to write about anything, any 10 things, without any other further direction. At the end of those 10 weeks, guess what? The first group, which was asked to write about something they were thankful for, reported feeling 25% more happier than the other two groups. Emmons then went on to write multiple books on happiness and gratitude. For example, he wrote one book called Thanks, How the New Science of Gratitude Can Make You Happier. It's a must read, they say. Sonia Labermeski, the professor of Department of Psychology, University of California, and the author of The How of Happiness, describes gratitude as the meta, quote unquote, meta strategy to achieve happiness. She says, gratitude is many things to many people. It's a wonder, it's appreciation, it's looking on the bright side of a setback. It's fathoming abundance, it's thanking someone in your life, it's thanking God, it's counting your blessings, it's savoring, it's not taking things for granted, it's coping, it's present mind, it's present oriented. There's another benefit another study came up with for having a thankful heart or a gratitude. It says this, and that your physical vitality improves. Gratitude improves our physical health. First of all, it relieves stress. Stress has been proven to be a major cause for heart attacks and other chronic conditions, as we might be aware of. Optimism, though, turns us and has been linked to increased immunity-boosting cells. Quote, grateful people take care of themselves and engage in more protective health behaviors like exercise, a healthy diet, and regular physical examinations, Emmons told the WebMD. A study conducted by the California-based on Paul Mills, professor of family medicine at University of California, says, a grateful heart is indeed a healthy heart. Your personal relationships get stronger if you desire to have a grateful mentality. Gratitude helps bring people closer together. This appreciation is not only seen when the other person within your relationship is positive, but also negative. You have a grateful mentality no matter what. That helps to bring about closeness, they wanted to say. It fosters a sense of commitment toward one another and a growing relationship. Individuals are more thoughtful in their words and actions to the other person, and that includes even greater closeness. Feeling appreciation and value by the other person makes a world of difference to the relationship and helps it grow stronger. Alan Barton of the University of Georgia affirmed this. He said this, we found that feeling appreciated and believing that your spouse values you directly influences how you feel about your marriage and how committed you are to it. And your belief is, and that your belief is that it will last ongoing. Also stated by co-author Ted Futris. Another thing that you can get a benefit from being grateful is that you'll be more resilient. Noticing and appreciating our blessings regularly attunes us to noticing the good out of everything and everyone. And that helps us to be more positive. This constant attention to seeing the good in every situation helps us bounce back stronger and quicker. Barbara Fredrickson, the author of Positivity and Love 2.0, attributes gratitude to be a key factor in building resilience. She says this, when adversity strikes, gratitude for the things that are going right in your life helps put tragedy in perspective. She wrote of a tactic. She said tactic she recommends is called unadapting, which means involving drawing attention to the things that we take for granted in our lives, like a roof over our heads, a steady career, food, and other things. This cultivates an abundance mindset, leading us to stronger abilities to bounce back in adverse situations. Another thing that can happen if I maintain a grateful mentality is I'll sleep better. You and I sleep better. Instead of counting sheep, count your blessings. It'll help you sleep. Gratitude promotes a feeling of trust in all is well in my world. And this in turn helps you sleep better by reducing your stress and worry about day-to-day things. One study conducted measured the quality of quantity of sleep in its participants as a result of expressing gratitude. The study confirmed the positive effects of gratitude on sleep. People slept longer, woke up less, felt more refreshed when partaking in a gratitude practice. Lastly, another thing studies have found is that your life satisfaction score grows up. Studies conducted and summarized in the paper show a definitive uptick with one's life satisfaction. Positive thoughts leading to thoughtful positive actions increase physical vitality, stronger relationships, optimistic thoughts, all together cause an overall increase in one's sense of well-being. Emmons went on to say, don't leave thanks at the Thanksgiving table. Gratitude is a muscle in us that needs to be built consciously. Maintain a gratitude practice that works for you and your schedule and stick to it daily. And they gave different examples. One of the things that we as Christians talk about is a thing called a quiet time, personal devotions with God. They mentioned having a reflecting time. That helps you develop a mindset of gratitude. All these things, Gia went on to say, the power of gratitude. All these things helped us to see from a practical perspective that being grateful, being thankful, having the mentality of being thankful helps us get better, even though that's not even our desire. The more we're able to be thankful as individuals, the more positive mindset we have, and therefore more positive life looks, and the more resilient, healthy, etc. we can be. Pretty cool. So there's something to being what God says we should be anyways. Grateful. But how do we do it? Let's be honest. Maintaining a thankful heart isn't easy, is it? It's not. We know that we hear from Madame Blueberry. We should. I remember years ago watching an old, I think it was a Disney film, Pollyanna. Did anyone see that movie? And it seemed like that's great and, you know, be positive, and I thought, yeah, but positive just for positive sake? There was an old song, a song came out some years back, Don't Worry, Be Happy. Don't worry, be happy. Sounds good. Actually, we can see now from the science there's truth in that. That's scriptural. But it can seem hollow, can't it? When you're going through hard times. It can seem hollow to don't worry, be happy, when things don't seem so positive and some so great to be thankful in or about. And yet the Bible says we should. How do we do that? It's a funny story of a pastor who made a personal note to always be thankful. He had a personal commitment that no matter what, he was going to never say anything negative, and you'll always see something thankful or positive to God from it. He was a pastor of a church in North Dakota. When there, of course, in the winters, it gets freezing cold, blizzardy at times. And this particular Sunday, it was especially bad, blizzardy like crazy. And, I mean, so bad that very few people could make it to church and tried. And the few that did, they said, okay, we got them this time. There's no way this pastor is going to be able to be positive. Well, how is he going to be able to express God thanks in these terrible conditions? Yeah, the service began, and the pastor opened the service, and he said, Lord, we just want to thank you that most days are not as miserable as today. Not always easy to be thankful, is it? It isn't. How can we be thankful when we're going through hard times? How can you be thankful if you just got news from the doctor that's the third miscarriage has happened? How can you be thankful when you just got the news from your boss that they're laying off, and I'm sorry, but you're one of them, and it's pretty close to Christmas? How can you be thankful when your children are going the direction, or grandchild, the direction that everything opposite of what you tried to teach and prayed for so long. How can you be thankful of a spouse's dream? Have you heard about a terminal disease, et cetera, et cetera? You know what I mean. How do you give thanks in those kind of situations? Should we really? And yet the Bible exhorts us to maintain a thankful heart in all circumstances. Look with me at 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 18. Paul wrote this, "Be thankful in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you who belong to Christ Jesus." Seems pretty clear cut. God does want us to be thankful in all circumstances. There it is. And I appreciate the Bible. Well, people say, it depends how you interpret it. You know, there's not too many ways you can interpret that. There is what it is. It says what it says. Look at our passage we read earlier, Ephesians chapter 5, verse 20. "And give thanks for everything to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ." We are to give thanks for everything. Now, we need to be clear. This isn't saying, "God, I thank you for incest. God, I thank you for child molestation." It's not saying that. It's saying that you can maintain a thankful heart in the midst of it, even the worst of tragedies. That's what this is saying. And we believers have been given an ace up our sleeve, so to speak, a reason for which we can always be thankful, and a way we can do that. We're going to look at it. It's not Pollyanna. There's substance behind the statement. And we're going to look at that. We've already seen the value in it, even just from a practical perspective. But there's a statement I want us to look at that helps us, that kind of leads into where we're going. And it goes like this. "Gratitude raises the altitude of my attitude when I trust in God's rectitude." There's a lot of oods in there. "Gratitude raises the altitude of my attitude when I trust in God's rectitude." We're going to unpack what that means. But there's depth in here that we're going to see. This is saying, though, I can truly be thankful. My disposition or my attitude can rise when I'm truly happy. And there's a basis for it. Now, just like the studies we've seen, and I read through a little bit, if we have a truly thankful heart, our emotional state will help us. We'll get less, we get less stress. We can be more at peace and happy. Paul wrote something about this in Philippians chapter 4, 4 to 7. Let me go ahead and read that, and you can follow along. It says this. Paul said, "Always be full of joy in the Lord. I say it again, rejoice. Let everyone see that you're considerate in all you do. Remember the Lord's coming soon. Don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Tell God what you need and thank him for all he's done. Then you'll experience God's peace, which exceeds anything we can understand. His peace will guard your hearts and minds as you live in Christ Jesus." I refer to this passage in my newsletter article that you might have received if you're on the church email list. And I talked about this, and I said that hidden in this little passage is a key little statement about thanksgiving being a key aspect for answered prayer. And it is. There's something I didn't allude to there, though, that's also found in this passage. But it refers to the context, which we actually read the context of it here today. And that is, there's a connection between thanksgiving and joy. There's a connection between my being happy or joyful and being thankful. Joy helps me to be thankful. Oh, and by the way, being thankful helps me to be joyful. They kind of go hand in hand. My attitude, my disposition is really largely based on my thankfulness. And when I'm thankful, I get joyful. And when I'm joyful, I get thankful. They help. They enhance one another. It's kind of cool to know that. And this helps me, that the attitude of joy helps me to be thankful in the midst of difficult circumstances that I'm praying about. And that's what this is talking about. And again, conversely, when I'm thankful, it helps me to maintain a joyful disposition. Gratitude raises the altitude of my attitude. That's what this is saying. But how? How do you and I maintain that joyful attitude? How do we get a grateful always attitude, especially during difficult circumstances? goes back to the condition of our key phrase. Remember what we said? We say gratitude raises the altitude of my attitude when I trust in God's rectitude. Okay, what's that? Well, that's a good word, rectitude. What's that rectitude referring to? Rectitude refers to that which is righteous, faithful, and dependable. It means to have the highest integrity. In other words, what this is saying is, when I trust in God's faithfulness to keep his promises. I can have a raised attitude. My attitude will have a higher altitude when I trust in God's faithfulness and keeping his promises. If I believe that God's good for it, that makes me anticipate something positive. And when I anticipate something positive, that raises my attitude. I'm more joyful about it. I can be thankful in it. And there is some neat promises that we can look at, which we will look at, as a matter of fact. But this is a condition. I need to trust in God's faithfulness, and that's key. You see, I need to maintain a mindset that no matter when God says something, that's it. There used to be these old slogans. God says it, I believe it, that settles it. That's what this is saying. This is saying when God's made a promise, I'm going to believe it no matter what. You can take it to the bank because God always keeps his word. Now we say, yeah, I get that, but how much do we believe that in here? And by the way, that's key. That's key. I got to get it from here to here. If I get it from here to here, then my attitude starts changing. Right? But it's a decision. I decide, you know what, I'm going to believe that God's going to do what he says. And God's given us some promises, some really cool promises. And his rectitude, that means his integrity, is perfect. It's impeccable. So I can trust him. If God's given me a promise that no matter what can make me have hope, and he has, then you know what? I will bank on that, and that's going to help me have strength in the situation and will raise my countenance. I will be happier. The altitude of my attitude will be positive because of gratitude, because I'm banking on God's rectitude that he's going to keep his word. That's what this is talking about. Look with me at Psalms 91, verses 14 to 16. The Lord says, I will rescue those who love me. Take a note there. Now look at this. I will protect those who trust in my name. When they call on me, I will answer. I will be with them in trouble. I will rescue and honor them. I will reward them with a long life and give them my salvation. Those are promises there. So what are we going to do with them? If I believe them and I'm going to bank on them, guess what? I start becoming hopeful, thankful, joyful in the circumstance no matter what. Even if I don't see it. Abraham. Oh, Lord, you've given me so much stuff here. It's great, but what good is it if I can't pass it along to somebody else? I have to give it to my servant, so my servant and his family is going to get it because you haven't given me any kids. You know the story? And then God promised him, he's 86 years old, you'll have a kid. Boy, that takes faith to believe in that one, but what does the Bible say? And God, Abraham, he said, and Abraham believed or trusted God, and God counted it to him as righteousness. Because he believed them. He banked on the promise of God. And then God proceeded to take 14 more years to answer that promise. That's called testing faith and trust. But if we trust God, that raises my attitude. I have a higher altitude in my attitude because I then get grateful because of gratitude because I'm trusting him. Right? The altitude of my attitude is raised because of gratitude because I'm trusting in God's rectitude. And there's a promise that we can really bank on. There's a promise. We've been talking about the ace up the sleeve. What promise helps me maintain an attitude of gratitude? You want to get it? You actually, many of you know it. Some of you recite it all the time. How much do we bank on this thing? It's a great promise. I was thinking, you know what? We need to delve into this verse. This verse is one that you say, yeah, this is great, and it's all, but I think we treat it too surfacey. I think we need to delve in this verse. There's a lot in this verse. What verse? The one that tells us that God promises to work all of my experiences for my good. Hello? Look with me at Romans 8:28. And we know that God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to his purpose for them. This is saying no matter what I have to endure, God is going to turn it around for my benefit and for his glory. Every single thing. It doesn't matter what it is. That's the promise. That's what's meant about everything. Do you see any conditions in the everything? Does everything except? I don't see an except in there. Is there an exception clause in there? I don't see one. That's called a promise. Amen? No. Amen? There we go. How much do we believe that God's good for it? That's the word trust. How much do we trust that God's good for his word? That he's going to, no matter what I've gone through and what you've gone through, he's going to use it for good. I love it when Rick Warren says, God never wastes a hurt. I love that statement. Paul talked about that in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, that when we go through tough times, the God of all comfort comforts us in all of our afflictions so that then we can comfort others with the same comfort that God has comforted us. God never wastes a hurt. He always works everything together for good for those who love him and are called according to his purpose. It's a promise. Every time. It's astounding to me. No matter what you go through, no matter what we go through, if we choose to believe it and honor it like Abraham did, God will fulfill his promise. Are we going to trust him and therefore have that higher altitude and attitude through gratitude because of it? Have you ever felt astounded when you hear testimonies of people who endured such great tragedies, but God brought them through? Or they're in it right now. Maybe long term. But God's helping them through it, but they were enduring a lot. And even while they're continuing to endure, they say something like, and I wouldn't change a thing. Doesn't that ever astound you when you hear those kinds of stories? You know what I'm talking about? I mean, like Johnny Erickson Tati. Some of you might know her. She's the one that's paralyzed me for 40, 50 years now. Can't do anything, but she paints. Have you seen that? She paints with her, put paintbrush in her teeth. And Sherry and I have a sketch of on her, well, it's a print of her sketch that she's done with her teeth, because that's all she can move. Using Psalms 46, that God's our refuge and strength. And all she can do is move her head like this. And we have it on her wall. Astounding. Anyways. And I remember listening to her, of course, a number of times and seeing her. She's awesome. And her talking about, you know, she talked about how she prayed to God every day that God would just heal her. And she's had many people pray over and different things. But she said, and that's true. She said, but you know what? I wouldn't change a thing. She said, you know how close I've gotten to God because of my condition? And she said, I know full well. If that injury didn't play, she had a spinal injury, and that's why she got permanently paralyzed. She said, I know for a fact that that would have happened, that I wouldn't have had that close of a relationship with God. I would have been kind of lukewarm like I was before all this happened. But now I'm so tired, I wouldn't change a thing. I just thank him for the situation. I thank him for this. I hear that and I go, man, I don't know if I could do that if I was in a situation. You know what I mean? Are you with me? And yet she does, because she's got something that maybe I don't even have because of her circumstance. This week I had an opportunity to see this, because people banking on the truth that God's good for his word, they get he's going to work it for good, they get grateful in the circumstance. I seen that this week. I visited Bill McMullen in the hospital. Some of you have had a chance to do that as well. If you don't know, Bill suffered a stroke and had some partial paralysis of his left side. He's in the process of recovering, doing better. He should be coming home Wednesday to continue his process. He is doing better. But I tell you, he and I we had a great time. Forget which night it was. I've seen him a couple of times, this week, so I remember which one it was. But the last time, I think it was Thursday night. Anyways, yeah. And we were just talking. He said, you know, I thank God for my stroke. He said, because, and he starts banking on this Romans 8:28, working it for good. He said, you know, I've already seen God work it for good. He's had some opportunity to have some reconciliations with some close family member from it. Already. He said, that's already happened. So, and that wouldn't happen. That didn't happen until the stroke occurred. So I'm thanking God for this thing. He said, but that's just the beginning. There's other things. I can't wait to see what else God's going to do. I just want God to get all the glory here. And he and I were just kind of rejoicing together. We read that Psalms 91 about trusting in the Lord. He goes, yes, trust in the Lord and promises. Amen. And I trust you, Lord. And we prayed together. And he was doing it. And he was being joyful from it. You see, his gratitude raised the altitude of his attitude because he trusted in God's rectitude. Amen? It makes all the difference. It goes back to us. What are we going to do, you and I, personally? Do you want a heightened attitude? Try gratitude in a faithful God. I'm having a shortened message today, because we're going to do something different today. Ooh. You got to know something about me. I believe not just in talking the talk, but in walking the walk. And a little earlier, we had asked people to say what you're thankful for. But we're going to take it another level right now. I need two of these. I got one right here. What we're going to do is we're going to ask people who would like. You can just stand. But we're going to say, offer about 5 minutes or so, an opportunity to just say prayers of thanks to the Lord. Anybody can. Here are some couple conditions. One. If anyone can do this, but one, if you get the mic, you can't talk to us. There's only person you can talk to is him. And two, when you talk to him, we're not going to do any requests this time. We do that all the time. This is just thanksgiving to him. Just saying prayers of thanks to him. And three, keep it brief, straight to the point, so don't do your whole litany, you know, right now, because there's going to be other people who'd like to say a prayer of thanks to, and we want to be sensitive to our time, so about 5 minutes or so. Okay, and so if we can't get to everybody, okay, then that's okay. I'll just kind of cut in, or maybe we'll be done quickly. We'll see how God does on this thing. But I want to have a time where during church we have a time of just giving thanks to God as a church. Amen? Are you with that? Okay, so all you have to do is just raise your hand, and we got a couple different people. The other person, someone else want to pass this around? We're starting already? Okay. All right. Okay, thank you. And Preston, can you, do you want to start this? Would that be fine? Okay, thank you. Okay, let me say a prayer of thanks, and then Preston will go. And then we'll just keep passing the mic to raise your hand kind of quickly so we can keep going, so there's no much interruption there. Father God, we want to thank you so much for this time. And Lord, you're an awesome God. And so, Father God, you deserve all of our thanks. We need to trust you, the Lord. That's the condition for having a grateful heart that raises the altitude of our attitude. So, God, we ask right now you would just be blessed by our thankfulness, because you deserve it all. We praise you and thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Dear Heavenly Father, I just want to thank you for all I've been through my entire life. I thank you for the pain, the suffering, the mistakes, the sin, the violence, the blessings, everything. I thank you that I have no regrets for my life. I thank you because you sent Jesus Christ to die for all of it. I thank you for salvation. I thank you that I can get up in the morning and thank you. I thank you that I can thank you all day long, no matter the pain, the suffering, whatever. Family problems, no matter what, Lord. You give me the heart to thank you, even when I don't understand. Thank you, Lord, that I can stand here this morning, whereas one point I was scared to stand before anybody. I thank you for boldness. I thank you for the Spirit of the living God that resides in me. I thank you for breaking me down and praising your holy name. I thank you that you're primary in my life. I thank you for my family. I thank you for my friends. I thank you for this church and the brothers and sisters here that have embraced me. I thank you for pain and suffering that shows me who I am in you. Thank you for all things in Jesus' name. Thank you. Thank you, Lord.
Amen.
Thank you.
Father, you're an awesome God. I thank you, Lord. I thank you for this day, Father, for breath and life. And thank you for Jesus. Thank you for that. He has made it possible for us to give you thanks. Thank you, Lord, that you love us to such an extent that you would give us your own son. Thank you, Lord, that he has given us the ability to be called sons of the Most High God. And we praise you for that. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father, that you do not hold our sins against us. Thank you, Father, that you're always quick to forgive. Thank you, Father, that you love us with an everlasting love. Father, we thank you. I thank you. I thank you, Lord, that you have given me life when I was dead. Thank you.
Thank you, Father, for loving me so much. Thank you, Father, for healing me many years ago so that I'm able to serve in the capacity that you've given me. And I thank you, Lord, for my family and the way you sustained us throughout this time. Continue to give us strength and energy. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Thank you, Heavenly Father, for the pain and suffering that I sometimes feel. Thank you for a friend and a husband and a lover, but changing him to also be a caregiver, Lord. Thank you for putting me in a position where I was humbled, where I had to learn to depend on somebody else, Lord. And thank you, Lord, for your strength and your comfort that you give to me every single day, Lord. Thank you for teaching me how to just give it up and not take it all on my own shoulders, Lord, for slowing me down, Lord. I just thank you, Lord, for just teaching me that sometimes I need to give it up to you, Lord, to be strengthened by you, Lord, and to have you be my comfort and my shelter, Lord. Thank you in Jesus' mighty name.
Father God, Lord, I just want to praise you, Lord, that your word is true. Lord, that you are faithful and you do provide for us and you give us more than we ask or imagine. Lord, I just thank you that I have seen your hand in my family and I've seen your hand in my parents. And I just thank you that I have seen you work. Lord, I thank you for that privilege of being a part of that.
Father, we thank you for safe travels for Lonnie and Sherry Anderson's daughter and that she's here to worship with us this morning. Thank you.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
Heavenly Father, I want to thank you for opening my eyes, helping me to see the true light in this world. You are the grace and the God that we all need to look forward to. Thank you for all of your blessings. In Jesus' name I pray.
Father God, we want to thank you, Lord, just for the moment we can have as a church to thank you. Lord, you have done so much. You are doing so much. We can see what you're doing in the lives of people. We hear about things like with Bill and just seeing you work and being thankful in that, Lord, even in tough circumstances. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for how you've been using this church, Lord God, how this week we had an opportunity, Lord, to have a good time serving people in our community. And Lord, it seems like you're opening your door with Kingwood Middle School. We want to thank you for that opportunity as well, Lord. We see that you're answering prayers, and we want to thank you for that, God. You're such an awesome God. You have the wind at our back because of you already working through answered prayer. Lord, you do answer prayer, and we want to praise you and thank you for that. Lord, we want to thank you for the fact that we can come to you and know that we have a God that cares for us and loves us and that causes all things to work together for good, for our good. Lord, for your glory. We praise you for that. Lord, what a promise that we have. Lord, an opportunity. Lord, we can always be thankful because we know that you're going to always work it for good, and we can bank on that. We thank you, God. We praise you and we love you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Thank you all. Right now, I want to conclude with watching a little bit more Madam Blueberry, and then we'll go right into communion.
Was a sad thing that Madame Blueberry's house had become a big pile of smashed sticks. But with her hard-working butlers and her nice new friends, Madame knew everything was going to be just fine. And most important of all, this once very Blueberry was truly thankful that day for everything she had, and seemed, though it may have been the late afternoon light, not quite so blue.
How did that song go again? Let's see.
We thank God for this day, for the sun in the sky, for the friends that we have, for our yummy apple pie, for the love that he shares, 'cause he listens to our prayers. That's why we say thanks every day. Because a thankful heart is a happy heart. We're glad for what we have. That's an easy way to start. For the love that he shares, 'cause he listens to our prayers. That's why we say thanks every day. That's why we say thanks every day.
Prepare for communion.
Communion. If you look it up in the dictionary, one definition is the interchange or sharing of thoughts and emotions, or intimate communication. It is the act of sharing or holding in common. This would be the description of Thanksgiving and the Thanksgiving season, of course. The first Thanksgiving was getting together to celebrate the harvest, which was vital to their survival. There was thankfulness for the produce and the realization that without it, there would be potential suffering. Jesus arranged for a time of gathering together during the time of the Passover to be in communion with his disciples. It was a time of being thankful for deliverance from Pharaoh and escape from bondage in Egypt. Matthew 26, verses 17 through 19. Now, on the first day of unleavened bread, the disciples came to Jesus saying, "Where will you have us prepare for you to eat the Passover?" He said, "Go into the city to a certain man and say to him, 'The teacher says, my time is at hand. I will keep the Passover at your house with my disciples.'" And the disciples did as Jesus had directed them, and they prepared the Passover. While they were there, Jesus served bread and wine to represent the sacrifice and the suffering that he would endure on the cross and to look forward to a future celebration. Matthew 26, verses 26 through 29. Now as they were eating, Jesus took bread, and after blessing it, broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body." And he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink it, drink of it, all of you. For this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many in for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will not drink again of this fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom." Paul used a Greek word, koinonia, to express the basic meaning of the Christian faith, a sharing of the life and death of Christ, which radically creates a relationship of Christ and the believer and of the believers with one another in a partnership or unity. So, as we are celebrating our freedom from the penalty of sin and the healing that is paid for by Christ's death, let's not forget the suffering that Christ endured to pay the price. 1 Corinthians 11, verses 28 through 32. "Let a person examine himself then, and so eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without discerning the body eats and drinks judgment on himself. That is why many of you are weak and ill, and some have died. But if we judged ourselves truly, we would not be judged. But when we are judged by the Lord, we are disciplined so that we may not be condemned along with the world." So here at North Park, we have an open communion, open to anyone that has accepted salvation through Jesus Christ. So please feel free to partake with us with a celebration and a thankfulness and with the sober spirit. Let's pray. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for doing what you did, for sacrificing yourself for our freedom so that we could be thankfully part of your kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
And I just wanted to invite people just to say, if you haven't yet made a decision for Christ, or you're not sure where you stand with the Lord, or you want to get it right with Him again, in your program there, you'll see a little connection card they refer to. And on the bottom of that connection card, which you can put in the offering bag, it just says you're interested in knowing more about Christ or baptism. It even has a Discovering God study in there. That's helping know God about God. If you're interested in any of those things, would you just check that on that box, on that card, and then you can put an offering plate. That'd be great. Thanks.
So when it comes to giving, if you've never experienced this thing in my face, if you have never experienced the blessings that follow tithing regular, ask somebody that has. It will amaze you how the Lord honors those who honor Him. And of course, if you go beyond that and give an offering too, consider this verse, Luke 6:38. Give, and it will be given to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together. That sounds like a pile to me. Running over, will be put into your lap. For with the measure you use, it will be measured back to you. Let's pray. Thank you, Lord, for speaking to our hearts and our minds. And let us be obedient to you in our giving as well as our time. In Jesus' name, amen.